Glory to God. Hallelujah. He reigns forever. Hallelujah. Glory to God. How many came to worship God this morning? Oh, my God. Hallelujah. He's awesome. Amen. Hallelujah. He's a good, good God. Hallelujah. I want you to help me sing this morning. God is a good God. Yes, he is. God is a good God. Yes, he is. He's a good, good, good God. Yes, he is. He's a good, good, good God. Yes, he is. Your soul not anchored in Jesus, you will surely drift away. There's a storm out over the ocean, and it's moving this away. If your soul not anchored in Jesus, you will surely drift away. Drift away, Lord, drift away. To God. There's a storm out over the ocean and it's moving this way. And if your soul not anchored in Jesus, you will surely drift away, because God is a good God. Yes, he is. Yes, he is. Yes, he is. Let's receive Deacon Richard Neville's with prayer this morning, followed by the word by Brother Ray. Amen. Receive him in that order.
Precious Lord and Savior, it is again that we come with thanksgiving. Come giving you praise, Almighty God. Because of you, you woke us up this morning, oh God. You let us travel over the road and get here safely, oh God. So we say we thank you, oh God. We pray for those that are going through a healing process, oh God. We speak healing to them in the name of Jesus, oh God. Remember the bishop that will bring forth the word this morning, the praise team, oh God. As we usher your spirit here, oh God, we invite you to sup with us, Almighty God. We invite you to receive our worship this morning, oh God. We pray that you touch those that come in that don't know you as a Savior, oh God. We pray for those that are sick in body this morning, oh God. Oh Lord, we just thank you because you're a great God and you're worthy of our praise, oh God. We pray that everything we say and do be for your praise and your glory. In Jesus' name, and everybody say amen, amen and amen.
Praise the Lord, saints. We'd like you to invite your attention today to Joshua. It's in the Old Testament. Electronic devices are allowed, but we prefer the old-fashioned Bible. Joshua 9, verse 22 to 27. When you have it, say amen. And we begin reading. And Joshua called for them, and he spake unto them, saying, Wherefore have you beguiled us, saying, We are very far from among you. We are when you dwell among us. Now therefore are you cursed, and you, none of you shall be freed from among bondmen, and being hewers of wood and drawn of waters for the house of my God. And they answered Joshua and said, Because it was certainly thy servants, How did the Lord thy God commanded his servant Moses to give you all the land and to destroy the inhabitants from the land from where you before were sought afraid of our lives because of you, and you have done this thing. And now, behold, we are in thy hand, as it seemeth good and right to them, unto them to do us. And so did he unto them, and delivered out them out the hand of the children of Israel, that slew them not. And Joshua made them that day of hewers of wood and drawers of water for the congregation and for the altar of the Lord, even unto this day, in the place which he should choose. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading and the hearing and the understanding of his word.
Hallelujah. Now we shall receive ignition at this time with a hearty amen. Put your hands together and praise the Lord for him. Amen.
Hallelujah.
Thank you.
a God that is able to do exceedingly and abundantly above all things that we could ask for. Glory, hallelujah. These young ladies are singing, He's able. Thank you, Jesus. Exceedingly above. Yes, Lord. Hallelujah. This next song says, fill me up, God, till I overflow. I want to run over. How many of you have that testimony today? We serve a God that is able, and we serve a God that is strong and mighty. He's a provider in our time of need. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, God. Hallelujah.
Provide the fire. I provide the sacrifice. You pour out your spirit. I will open up inside. Fill me up, God. Fill me up, God. Fill
me. Praise the Lord, everyone. Praise the Lord, everybody. Hallelujah. We might be few in number, but God is here. Amen. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. For the Bible tells me so. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. For the Bible tells me so. It don't matter what you're going through. It don't matter what folk are saying about you. It don't matter what's going on in court or with the landlord or with the utilities department. Yes, Jesus loves me. You might have even got told off at work. Yes, Jesus loves me. The enemy might have came and said, God don't hear your prayers. Yes, Jesus loves me. For the Bible tells me so. Come on, put your hands together and give the Lord a praise. What a great day to be in the kingdom. What a great time to be in this kingdom. What a great season to be in God's kingdom. Hallelujah. We're blessed beyond measure because of who our Father is and who we're in covenant relationship with. And that's what I want to talk a little bit about today, covenant relationships. Amen. Father, in the precious name of Jesus, we come to you, we give you praise, and we honor you. We thank you, Lord, for letting us lay down last night and rising up this morning, clothing our right mind with the activities of our limbs. We thank you, Lord, for the Holy Ghost yet abiding in our soul. We thank you, Lord, for your favor that follows us all the days of our life. Father, we thank you, Lord, for generational blessings, Lord, not only in ours, but in the lives of our friends and family. In the name of Jesus. Now, Father, we ask, Lord, that you may anoint this piece of clay. Let nothing be said through strife or vainglory. Lord, but all be edifying unto you. And we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah. I'm not sure where we're going to start. I know where I want to end. And we'll let the Lord take care of the ending at the beginning and put us on the right track. But I want to talk to you about mankind, how God made this man named Adam and placed him into the garden that he had prepared for him and gave him the command to dress the garden, in other words, to keep it up, make sure no weeds are growing and make sure that everything is all right, and gave him dominion over the whole earth. Dominion means authority. He gave him the authority over the earth, and he said, look, man, this is yours. I need you to take care of it for me. Only one thing that I ask you not to do is do not eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. All the rest of the trees you can just eat from freely. plenty of water going through the garden. You got everything you need. Oops, except one thing. He put him to sleep, and he made him a helpmeet. He said, it's not good for man to be alone. So he made him someone that would be with him. And as they were normally doing their job, and that job was to take care of the garden, the serpent, the Bible say he was kind of a sneaky rascal. He was kind of sneaky, and he began to talk to the woman. And as he was talking to him, we understand that they had spoken previously by the conversation that's going on right now. And he asked her, did God tell you that the day that you would eat of the fruit, you would surely die? And she said, he told us not to eat of it and not to touch it, as we will surely die. And he said, you shall not surely die. But God knows that when you eat of this fruit, you will become wise like him. And that fascinated the woman. Now, I'm not blaming the blame on the woman. I'm blaming the blame on the man who was with the woman. Actually, they both could take blame. But since the man was in charge and the first one born, the first one made, the first one created, we're going to make him the blame. So she took of the fruit and she did eat and gave it to her husband, the Bible says, who was with her, and he did eat. And the minute they ate, they realized something about themselves. They realized that they were naked. They had fallen and they had did more than disobeyed God. They had given the kingdom to the enemy. Whenever we disobey God, God looks at it as rebellion against him, his authority, and his word. The enemy will tell you that there's no harm in it. It just, all you got to do is repent. But God said, I'm looking at the heart. You know, so many times people say they repent, but they haven't repented because they go back and do the same thing all over again. So that caused them to get kicked out of the garden. I know you know all of this. We have many Bible scholars sitting among us. That caused them to be kicked out the garden. But God didn't kick them out of his care. He still loved them. He was looking for a way to bring them back unto him. It took 42 generations for Jesus to be born, to be the Lamb that will bring man back unto God. Jesus cared so much that he died for him. He became the living sacrifice. Instead of a lamb, instead of a goat, instead of a dove, he became the sacrifice. And he said, for this cause came I into the world. The reason I'm here is to die for mankind. No wonder the angels asked, well, who is man that thou art so mindful of him? Why you love man so much? Look at all the destruction and all of the dirty things that man has done. And even the fact that God said he repented that he even made man, but he still loved man because man was his prized creation. Man was the only thing that had the Spirit of God dwelling on the inside. Man was in the likeness and the image of God. He's the only one that had that testimony. Man was just a little lower than the angels, but he had great favor with God. And so God loved man. God looked for someone to come and redeem man, but he couldn't find nobody. So he said, I'm going myself. I'll make myself a body. See, because God is a spirit. And as long as he was God, as long as he was in the spirit form, he could never die. He had dominion. It took 42 generations just to not have authority over death and have death have authority over him. It took that many years. So we begin to look and we see that Jesus came and died as ransom for our sin, or as payment for our sin. I want you to understand that you might owe a lot of people. You might owe the bank. You might owe the utility company. You might even owe one another, but you don't owe God. Not in the sense that you feel that I owe him money or that my goodness and my good deeds are going to be of value because of who God is in my life. But I want you to know you don't owe God like that. You owe God to tell of his goodness. How we repay God back for the sacrifice that he made is to love one another and to care for one another. Now, I admit that some people are a little harder to love than others. Now, y'all know I'm telling the truth. We got people in our family that ain't so lovable. The only reason we like them is because they're in the family. So Jesus came, gave his life for our sins. And when he came to give his life for our sins, he said, but if you would confess me, if you believe that I am of the Father, that I am the bread that come down from heaven, that I am eternal life, I am the resurrection and the life. If you believe those things and confess me, then I will be in covenant with you. And then to be in covenant, it means that we will be joined together. Deeper than a blood covenant, it'll be a love covenant. It'll be a covenant that I will always take care of you. I will always be there for you. I will always be your help. So we find that when we confess Jesus and accept him as our personal Savior, that he justifies us. And when he justifies us, he gives us everything we need to be successful. He gives us everything we need to get to heaven. We have forgiveness. We have love. We have the ability to walk straight. But he said, and I found this very interesting, he gave us all of these things that we can make it, but he said, but ye shall have power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you. In other words, you have all these things, but you don't have any power how to use them. It's like having a gun. You have a gun and the robber come and you have the gun and you forget to take the safety off. Or you didn't even know it had a safety. But ye shall have power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you. We find today that people are so interested in being justified, and they should be. They could go to the Lord and ask the Lord, Lord, forgive me for my sins. But Paul kind of explains that a little bit in chapter 6 of Romans. He says, shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? Even though we have the power of God and we're in covenant with God, we should be growing every day away from sin. Our thinking should be going away from sin, doing the wrong thing, and we should be waking up in the morning saying, Lord, I'm reporting for duty. What can I do to advance the kingdom today? Lord, what can I do to give you praise today? What can I do to enhance you today? Because he works through us. But we can't do that until we receive power. After that, the Holy Ghost, when we get the power of the Holy Ghost, we can lay hands on the sick, and the sick shall recover. We should drink any deadly thing, and it will not harm us. Things happen when we receive the Holy Ghost. So just don't settle for the baptism of man or in water, but get the baptism of the Holy Ghost, speaking in other tongues as the Spirit of God give the utterance. The Holy Ghost. It will lead and guide you into all truth. The Holy Ghost will let you know when somebody's lying to you. You might not say nothing. You might not say, well, you just lying your head off. You might not say a word. But you know. And you know what else you know? You know when somebody professing and not possessing. They're confessing that they have what they really don't have. Because if they had what they say they have, they wouldn't act like they do. How many know that the Holy Ghost will change your mode of operation? It'll change your conversation. It'll change your walk. It'll take you where you cannot take yourself. The Holy Ghost will allow you to love the unlovable. Yeah. Oh, yes, it will. It'll make you love folks that did you wrong. You know, it'll make you love folks that you know are talking about you. It'll make you love them even though they don't like you. That's the way the Holy Ghost is, because it will take you beyond your flesh and your own thinking. We're in covenant with Him. So what is this covenant thing? Grace New Covenant Worship Center. Grace New Covenant Apostolic Church. What is this covenant deal? Covenant says that we're together. My interests are your interests, and your interests are my interests. Covenant. So we find that God honors covenant. He loved the children of Israel, and He gave them the land of Canaan. And He told them to go in and possess the land. And He told them, He said, there's people already there, but I'm giving you power and authority over them. I'm taking what is theirs and giving it to you. You know, that don't seem quite fair. But favor ain't never fair. I want you to think about that. He says, now, it's possessed, the land is possessed with people, and I don't like these people. Because they worship idol gods. And they do vile things with them in their worship. So don't come in league with them. What He's saying is don't make covenant with them. Don't become in league with them. But stay there. I want you to bring them into servitude and even destroy them. But there was one man by the name of Gibeon. Gibeon went to Israel, and he knew that they wouldn't accept him. So what he did, he said, give me some moldy food. I'm going to take that with me. Give me some sandals that's kind of raggedy. And give me garments that's kind of dirty and coming apart and holy. And let me go and talk to the leaders of the children of Israel. Let me go talk to Joshua. So they went in and they said, we want to come in league with you. And Joshua told them, you can't do it. And they said, well, we're not other people that live here. We come from a far place. Don't you see how the food is molded? How many know the enemy will try to put a trick on you? He said, look at our sandals. They all wore out. So the Bible says that Israel entered into league with them. They said, we have heard about your God and what He did to the Egyptians. I wonder if anybody has heard about your God. You know, back in the old days, they was very specific about whose God they wanted. We want the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. We want that God. See, because there were many gods, and there's still many gods, they're just in different forms today. But people worship a whole lot of different crazy stuff. But the only true God is Jesus Christ. The only one that said, I got all power in my hands. The one that had power over death and the grave. But somebody said, well, what about the Father? Jesus said, when you see me, you see the Father. For me and my Father, we are one. What the Father know, I know. What the Father can do, I can do, because we're one. There's no three. There's but one. So we find that after Israel listened to him, they entered league with them. And about 3 days later, they found out that they had been tricked. And they went to them and they said, well, why you trick us? Why'd you do that? But it was because of their negligence. They didn't investigate. But I can hear the word of God says, know them that labor among you. I have a saying, believe the story, but check it out. Yeah, check it out. They didn't check it out. So now, this thing went a little deeper than just a league with Israel, because Israel was in league with God. Whoever became in league with Israel became in league with their God. So they brought a bunch of liars in league with their God. And they wanted to know, well, what do we do? You know, God told them, honor the contract. Honor the agreement. Now, when the other fellas and the other people found out that Gibeon had got in league with Israel, they got angry with them and wanted to go to war. Fascinating story. But God said, don't worry about them. I've given you victory over them. I'm going to do some things to show who I am. Have you ever asked the Lord for something ridiculous? It was good, but it was ridiculous. And the only person that could do it was God. And this is what happened. When they got in the fight, only God can make the sun stand still. And that's what he did. Only God can make the battle last overnight. And that's what he did. He showed himself strong. I want to tell you today that God is looking to show himself strong in your behalf. Your personal problem, your personal going through. God wants to show himself strong just for you. And you know why he wants to do it? That your faith will be made strong and that you will give him praise. Your faith will be made strong and give him praise. When Joshua was promoted, he told him, only be thou courageous. As I was with Moses, I'm going to be with you. Only be thou strong and be thou courageous. Only be you strong in the faith and be courageous and use the power of the name of Jesus and watch God do some things that you're trying to do yourself. You can't do it. You can try and try. I remember when I was trying to stop smoking. I was trying, this was before I got saved. I was going to give it up. Gave it up for a couple of days. Football game came on. Backslid, went and got the cigarettes. But when I got the baptism in Jesus' name, when I repented of my sins, and they put me in that water, and the water was cold. Anybody know that water is cold? When I came up out of the water, in my mind said, smoke you a cigarette on the way home. Now, one of the mothers told me I had to get rid of the cigarettes, but she didn't tell me today. So So I tried to smoke that cigarette on the way home and got choked. Anybody ever got choked off of cigarette smoke? You can't hardly breathe, can you? No. I'm driving, can't hardly breathe, I'm choking. So I stopped. I wasn't weaned off. The Holy Ghost delivered me. I believe sometimes we weaken the Holy Ghost because we listen to what people say. We need to step the 12-step program. God's step is one, repentance. Repentance. If we would repent and trust God, I believe that God will show himself strong in all of our cases. He said, oh, yeah, they're trusting me. Look at them. They're rejoicing. And God just hurries up and come down and enthrone himself in our praise and in our worship. Hallelujah. And the more we worship, the higher we go in him, the stronger our faith becomes and the better our talk becomes. We have not because we ask not because we don't really believe. We don't really believe that I can have whatsoever I say. We read it, but we say, God made a mistake. I can't have what I say. But God said, if you believe that you receive when you pray, you shall have whatsoever you say. Say, I'm whole and healed. I have a granddaughter. She's up to 5 pounds now. Up to 5 pounds. When she chimed in, she weighed 2 pounds and 11 ounces. I received a call from April last night. And she said, Dad, she's got an infection, and the doctors were concerned. And I said, do you believe God? Oh, I can tell you some things. I can tell you how she was born with 2 holes in her heart. And the doctor said, we don't know about that. After a few days, 1 hole closed. You know why? Because the saints was praying. And she said last night, Dad, they say the second hole is getting smaller. When we trust God and enter in league with him, God honors what we say. God didn't tell Elijah to curse the land and that it didn't rain for 3 years. He didn't tell him to do that. He did it based on what Elijah said. He honored his prophet. God will honor the things that we say if we're in league with him because we're in it together. So let me finish my story. So April, she said, Dad, she was crying, and she was really crying. I heard over the phone, and the doctors called. And she was crying, so I just got on up and went to the hospital. And she said, I walked in, and I told, she was crying. She was just crying like I have never heard her cry before, the baby was. And she said, I picked the baby up, and I said, Mommy is here. And she said, Dad. She stopped crying and snuggled in. And not only did she snuggle in, she opened her eyes. And Dad, she smiled. And she said, and I lost it. Signs and wonders shall follow them that believe. Signs. God will do what we ask him to do. All we have to do is furnish the faith So what they did with these people, they made them servants all the days of their life. They wouldn't kill them because they couldn't kill them because they was in league with them. You can't kill somebody you got a covenant with. If they break the covenant, they broke the covenant. That's between them and God. But God comes in league. So we're in covenant with God. So it's not us that do the work of God. It's God that works through us. But we have to allow him. And we have to give him room to work. We have to furnish some faith to believe. You know what? When I lay hands on somebody, I expect what I'm asking God to do to happen. I expect folk to be healed. I expect people to be delivered. I expect people to be encouraged. I expect that. I have an expectation on the prayer because I'm in covenant with God. It's not me. I'm yielding myself over to him. I'm just a conduit for him to work through. So if it don't happen, I'm not all upset because the pressure is not on me, it's on God. Who can do anything but lie? He's a God that can't lie. And if he said he can do anything but fail, then he can do anything but fail, but he cannot lie. So if he can't lie, then I have an expectation for him to do like he said. He said, you know what he said? He said, I have dreams toward you. The scriptures say he had thoughts, but he had dreams. He has an expected end. He means us good and not evil. You know what? God desires that we prosper. He don't want us to be, you know what? Let me tell you something. Doubt, guilt, feeling sorry for yourself, all of this is of the enemy. Because as long as you're feeling sorry for yourself, you can never do what God asks you to do. Because you know what? Sometimes you might not feel like doing what God asks you to do, but you got to step out of yourself and get into the spirit and let God use you. You got to step out. You know what? So many people are stuck in their self, but you got to get out of self. I got to leave my position in my body, and I got to go to the another realm so I can hear God. Because I believe God. When I go to the doctor and they start saying, well, you know, this is this, and that is that. And I say, well, why is this? They say, because you're getting old. I say, well, as long as you don't say I'm old, I'm getting there. But you know what? I tell them all the time. I say, the same way it came is the way it's going to leave. It came overnight. It's going to leave overnight. And you know what? In the meantime, I'm going to rejoice. We have to change our prayer. I'm excited. I'm excited about the new set of lessons that we have in Bible study. If you missed the last sessions, you really missed a good group of lessons. We're going to talk about having what you say, and what you say is what you get. You know, sometimes we pray and we ask the Lord to do a thing, and when we ask him to do it, we get up and say, well, we're going to see if he's going to do it. That shouldn't be how we get up. We should get up thanking the Lord for what he's done. Lord, I thank you for touching my body and healing my mind. Lord, I thank you for making a way. The way might not have been made. You might not see it, but that don't mean it hasn't been done. Just because you don't see it, you know what? The Bible lets us to know that he wants us to have prosperity, and just because I don't have no money in my pocket don't mean I'm broke. And even if my bank account is on zero, it don't mean I'm broke. I have access to my father's bank. And you know what he'll do? That same father would touch maybe my brother or my sister and tell them, give, and they'll walk up and just hand you money. Call it a Holy Ghost handshake. I heard the testimony of a lady who had 6 children and didn't have any food. And she said the Holy Ghost told her to go on her porch. When she went on the porch, there were 6 bags of groceries. To this day, she don't know where it came from. It don't matter where it came from. It came from God. God touched somebody's heart. We're in covenant with him. He's obligated himself to provide for our needs according to his riches and glory. But we have to feed ourselves the word of God. You know what? We can't listen to people because people have different agendas. They have different agendas. I need to talk to somebody that have faith. I need to talk to somebody that has $1 million type faith. I can get Washington's faith by myself. I don't need no help with that. I need $1 million. I need multi-$1 million faith people. I need people that can write a check. We need carpet for the church right now. We need carpet. Some of you already told us to get carpet, but I didn't give you the price tag because I didn't know it either. But we need somebody right now to write a check for $35,000 to get new carpet. We'll get new carpet. We'll get new tile. We'll make the place look really nice. And you know what? You can trust us. You can trust us that the money go where we said it went, on the carpet. See, I believe that God got business people and people that have that kind of faith. I believe that God is going to send in people that we're going to have to tell them, Sister Judy, you know what, we got more than enough. Can you imagine us telling somebody, Sister Margie, take your money and give it to the mission because we have more than enough? We have money enough that we don't even know what we're going to do with it. $1 million type faith. When you're connected with God, you know what? I have never seen God take a large group of people and do what he needed to do. He would tell them in a minute, you got too many. You know why? Because he wants to get the glory. He wants to get the glory. We're in league with him. We're in covenant with him. We have to understand our position so we can't put ourselves in compromising positions because of who we are and who we represent. The minute you say that I am saved, sanctified, filled with the Holy Ghost, or the minute you say I go to church, you have a target on your back. Somebody's watching you. You might say, oh, nobody's concerned about little old me. Somebody's watching your life. And the children are mocking you. We don't shout like we used to shout. But the children play church. You know, sanctified children, that's what they do. They play church. There's always one of the boys being the preacher. And the girls and the rest of them be dancing like the saints. Oh, they got somebody down. Then they be just laughing and having a good old time. But I'm reminded of a testimony by Shirley Caesar when they was playing church. And she got to calling on the name of the Lord. See, that's a name you can't play with because you're in league with him. When I call on the name of Jesus, I mean business. If I say, Lord, I need you to come right now, I need him to come right now. The centurion said, I'm not worthy that you should come under my roof. Just speak the word. That's all you got to do is say it. Just say it. Just say it. Say it. He honors what we say. We can say it and he agrees. Say it. You want to be whole and healed? Say it. I'm whole. I'm healed. Lord, I thank you for being whole. I thank you for being healed. I thank you, Lord, for this. I thank you for my children. I thank you, Lord, for my prosperity. I thank you, Lord, for making the way. I thank you, Lord, for the revelation of who you are. I thank you for opening up my understanding and giving me more faith, having my faith expanded. We don't get more faith. We expand the faith that we have. Because when we became justified, he gave us all the faith we needed. Now we have to stretch it. We have to stretch it. I'm in covenant. We're in covenant with God. We're justified. We're the righteousness of God on the earth. If the world don't see righteousness, no, you know what? We're looking for righteousness in the wrong places. We're looking for righteousness from politicians. And everybody know politicians lie. If I would ask you describe a politician, the first thing somebody would say, if they was on Family Feud, liar. Thief. Corrupt. But yet, we're looking for politicians to make everything all right. Honey, we're looking the wrong way. We got to look to Jesus. He's the only one that can change the heart and the minds of people. He can cause the crooked to become straight. It's going to take him. We're not surprised, and I'm almost finished. My time is up. But we're not surprised with what's going on in the world today. We're not surprised with floods and earthquakes and murders and wars and rumors of wars. All these things had been prophesied would come. Jesus said it. He said, but the end is not yet. He said, these things are going to happen, but it's just the beginning of sorrow. And we haven't even gotten into that yet. It's going to be a sad day to be living here without the Lord. They used to tell us they're going to close churches. And we thought when the church get closed, they put a lock on there and say it was the government. But you know what? The pandemic taught me that they can close churches. Churches can be shut up. But you know what? I'm the church. The building can be shut up, but the church will never get shut up. Long as I got a mouth and got a tongue and can make some sound, the church will never get shut up. I feel like shouting just on that principle right there. On that principle, the church will never get shut up. Because if I can't say a word, I wave my hand. The Lord told me one time, he said, you know what? When you need me, you just call on me. I was wondering, and I think maybe all preachers go through this. I was young, and I asked the Lord, I said, Lord, did you really call me to do this? Did you really call me to preach? Because I was ready to find something else to do in the church, like be an usher. That looked pretty safe. That didn't look too demanding. But he said, I called you, but not for right now. What he was saying is take this time and learn. For your time is not yet. That's what he said. And he said, but if you need me, all you have to do is call on me. And then he said, if you can't call on me, think on me. And I'll be right there. God is here right now to them that need and want him. I want more of him. I ask God every day, Lord, I want more of you. I prayed the prayer, Lord, crown my head with wisdom and knowledge and understanding. open up your scriptures to my understanding so I'll be able to teach your people. I prayed that prayer for years on years and years. I realize I've been saved for 50. I know I prayed that prayer for 25 of those 50. Ask the Lord to do that. And you know what he did? Whatever you need of God today, if you need something of the Lord, or you want something from God, I'm going to ask you to stand to your feet. We exalt thee, we exalt thee, O Lord, we exalt thee, we come on, let's give him praise. We exalt thee. We exalt thee. We exalt thee. Oh, Lord. Father, in the precious name of Jesus, Lord, we come to you. We thank you. Father, we thank you for waking us up this morning, for this is the best day ever. We thank you, Lord, for being clothed in our right mind. We thank you, Lord, for a mind to want to be in your service. And we ask, Lord, that you may open up our understanding to your word that was spoken on today. Help us to realize who we are. Help us, Lord, to be used of you. As you spoke to Ananias and asked him to go pray for one called Saul, help us to hear your voice. Slow us down, Lord, so we can talk with you and you can talk with us. Father, we give you praise for every prayer that you've answered and every need that you've met according to your riches and glory through Christ Jesus. Lord, we give you praise today because of who you are. We know the enemy is busy, but he's busy, but we have authority over him through you. For everything that you've overcome, we've also overcome because we are in covenant relationship with you. Father, we thank you for the children, future lawyers and doctors and politicians and honest politicians. We thank you, Lord, for them being ministers and pastors and evangelists and teachers of your word. Become good mothers and good fathers. Father, we ask even right now that one that feel that they're unable to reach anything in you, Lord, let your love cover them right now and let them feel the depth of your love for them. And let it cause an awakening that they will give their life totally unto you. Father, we thank you right now that all needs are met. Father, we thank you, Lord, for being healthy and whole. Regardless of what the doctors say, we know you hold the life, you hold life and death in the palm of your hand. And all you have to do is say one word, heal. And Lord, we'll be completely healed. And we thank you right now. And we ask it in Jesus' name. Come on, put your hands together and give the Lord a praise. Somebody just ought to shout hallelujah. The church should never be silent. The church will never hold its peace. The church will always declare who the Lord God is and always give him praise. I'm talking about the church of the living God. Upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail. It shall not have victory over it. It didn't say it wasn't going to come against it, but it shall not prevail. It shall not win. Amen. May the Lord ever bless you. May heaven ever smile upon you. For God is good and God is real. Amen. We have some that's out today, some key people that normally do different things. So we're going to ask you to prepare your offering. I know this is not...